parallel with his session is the hyper, the hyperscale, the serverless, which is will be delivered by Pio on Boracay Road. So anyone interested, please come with me. We're going to set up there.
Actively at Hands-On Architect. It's not handsome, because once I was talking about session and somebody introduced saying my blog is Hands-On Architect, then I had to say no, I'm not handsome, it's Hands-On. So I have some blogs written there, so the frequency of the use of it. Let's start with thanking the sponsors, Microsoft and DB Watch, for this wonderful event. I hope you will get to learn quite a lot during the day. Who am I? So I'm a Microsoft MVP for Azure. I have the blog, I have the links to GitHub, my Twitter account, LinkedIn over here. If you want to connect, you can use this. If you're connecting on LinkedIn, just mention that you are part of this event, not from where, okay. And my interests are like, obviously in technology, but when I don't talk about technology, like most Indians, I love the game of cricket. So if somebody wants to talk about cricket, happy to talk about it as well after this talk.
Okay.
So what's on the agenda today? We'll go through what are the components of modern data warehouse. We'll look at the architectural components. We'll have at least 3 to 4 different demos using the tools that are part of this architecture. And I'll provide you some references, and hopefully we'll have some time for Q&A. So let's get started with the components of modern data warehouse. Everybody talks about modernization nowadays. You hear people about modernizing applications, modernizing infrastructure. For almost everything you have as a service now, infrastructure as a service, you have data as a service. So data warehouse also can't be left behind. So here is one example where you can build a modern data warehouse using different services on Azure. I would like to give credit for this particular slide to a guy called James Serra. So if you're from a SQL background, you would have particularly heard about him. He's quite a famous guy. He's got a wonderful blog. He is active MVP and very knowledgeable guy when it comes to SQL. If you are really interested in enhancing your knowledge, I think you should follow him.
James Serra.
So I took this slide from one of his presentation, which is quite big in terms of like 230 slides in one presentation. I just took part of it. So what are the components that you need to build a warehouse nowadays when you talk about modernization? So you look at on the left hand side, you have different data sources on premise. So you have things like Oracle, SQL databases, Teradata, SAP. These are like traditional data sources. You also have cloud, so there's Azure, GCP. You have cloud data sources as well. And there is this software as a service like Salesforce, CRM, Dynamics. All this can be ingested into what we call as a data lake. So if you look at the data warehouses in the past, we used to have what is called as schema on write, where you define the schema of what you are going to store, and then you try to load the data into that schema. Whereas with data lake, the thing changes to schema on read. So you can store almost any kind of data, not just structured data. You can have PDF, you can have images, you can have audio files, videos, all going into your storage, because storage has become quite cheap nowadays with S3, with Azure Data Lake storage. And then you start processing that data. So there is this shift coming in, and that's where the storage part comes into the picture. You can use an online ETL tool or cloud native ETL tool specifically for Azure. It's called Azure Data Factory. This is the ingestion aspect. Then for preparation, you have a Data Factory, which provides like code-free UI. You can prepare your data using the different what we call as activities provided by Data Factory. You can also use Databricks. So anybody has heard about Apache Spark? You're using Spark? So Databricks is like a specialized service. Databricks is a company which maintains the code for Spark, and they provide a custom version of this Databricks runtime. And this is supported on AWS as well as Azure. So this is not the open source one. They have their proprietary things which is built on top of the open source tools of Spark, and that they offer as part of first party service as Azure Databricks. So if you are processing data, if you're building pipelines using Spark, you can use this. Then for transformation and enrichment, again, Data Factory can be used, Databricks can be used. And once the data is processed, once it is enriched, once it is transformed and it's ready for analytics purposes, we can store it in Azure SQL Data Warehouse. And this can be visualized using any visualization tool like Power BI, or if you're using Qlik, anything that can connect to the SQL Warehouse, you can use to visualize that. So let's go and look into each of these components in a little bit more depth, starting with the data lake storage. So Azure Data Lake Storage, this is object storage, similar to S3. So here, with Data Lake Storage, there are multiple versions. The most recent one is called Gen 2, or Generation 2. This offers one nice feature, which is called as HNS, or Hierarchical File System. What you get here is, let's say you are storing your files as objects. In the version 1, you have a logical file system. You don't have actually physical file system. You're storing objects just in one flat container. It just gives you a view like there is folder. You can create a sort of hierarchy, but actually on the disk where it is stored, there is no file system. Whereas with hierarchical namespace, you get that actual file system. So you can do things like create folders. You can give rights to the folders. And this works with backward compatibility with your blob storage, the version 1. So you have a blob API as well as ADLS API, which can be used to connect to this hierarchical namespace. So when you're communicating or when you're integrating your applications with this, the version 2, Gen 2 provides you a specific driver which is called as ADFS driver. This is optimized for this hierarchical namespace. And many of the documents, you would see the old version of the protocol used, which is called Windows Azure Blob Storage Driver, WSB. If you see WSB, and if you are using Gen 2, you should try to replace that with ADFS version, because this is more optimized, and this is the most latest version of the driver. So when it comes to using this as part of best practices, we should use things like security. Security is quite prominent and quite a necessity nowadays with data going on cloud. So you secure the storage using service principles. So service principles are like service accounts which you create in Azure, and you give rights to those service accounts. So when services communicate, so let's say Azure Databricks wants to communicate with the storage, you don't give rights to an individual user. You create a service account and you give rights for that user. So this is using service principle. You can also use security groups. So in case you have the need, like a support user account or specific user needs access, you can create a security group and you can add and remove users from the security group. This is much better option to grant permissions as compared to going and giving grants to individual users. And there is also options where instead of exposing your storage account publicly, you can enable a specific firewall. So you can say, I have, let's say, an office and it has a range of IPs. You don't want anybody outside of that IP range to connect to the storage. You can restrict the users using this option. So let's look at these on the portal. Instead of me just talking about these things, you will feel much more related to the concept if I show you how it is to be done. So anybody has used the portal before to create storage accounts?
Yes.
Or you're seeing it for the first time? How many are seeing this portal for the first time? Okay, so this is what you get when you log into your Azure portal. Based on your subscription and your privileges, you would get something similar. I have many resources. If you don't have any resources, this page would be like a default page. So let's say I want to create a new resource, a storage account here. I can either choose from these, like recently used or most commonly used. I can go to like computer, I can go to the analytics part to get the storage. Or I can just type here saying I want to create a storage account. And then when I click on create, it will ask me for various details like what subscription I want to use. I have multiple subscriptions, so it's showing me both the subscriptions here. What resource group I want to use. So resource group is basically collection of your related resources. I can create a new one or I can use an existing one. And then I have to give a name which has to be unique. Location, which data center I want to create this storage account. The type of performance, whether it's standard or premium. So your pricing would vary based on what you choose here. Based on which data center, which pricing tier you want, and what kind of account. So this is for the purpose of redundancy. When it comes to replication, these two are quite new ones. These are in preview. But usually you will find the four top ones, which is locally redundant, which means you will have three copies of your data stored within your data center. Zone redundant is you have the zones where data centers are residing, so you will have multiple copies in multiple zones. Geo redundant, so you can say I want my data to be in some other locality, some other geolocation. And the last one is read access, which is if there is a downtime or if there is an incident which happens, then you can still have geo redundant data, but only in read-only mode. You cannot write to it. And this option is enabled only by Microsoft. So So we cannot decide on this. We can just say storage is geo-redundant, read-only, but Microsoft will decide whether it has to be enabled or not. These three is under our control. The other two new ones, I haven't really explored them. Sorry, I can't talk about it right now since I saw it just today. And then you have the tier. So our tier. So you have two types, cool or hot. Hot is you will have instant access to it. Cool is like you're not going to access this data very frequently and you want to use it for, let's say, backup purpose. You want to keep it for, if your company has a policy, for example, to keep 7 years of data, you will put it under the cool tier. And the retrieval will be slightly slower in case of cool. Whereas hot, it's instant access. And then you can go and review and create, or you could also go to the other options like networking. And this is where you can choose how do you want to expose this for connectivity. Do you want all public endpoints, all networks to have access, or you want to have access to the selected networks? Then there are advanced options when it comes to transfer of data. So do you want to enable SSL transfer, secure transfer files, block storage, delete, Gen 2. This is important if you want to use that KBFS driver. When you say enabled, that's when you get that hierarchical namespace. Otherwise, it will use the default Gen 1 version. Okay. And then you create this. So once you hit create, it will take some time to create this account. So I've already created one for this demo. So let's go and look at that account which is already created. When you create the storage account, you get four types of files or four types of data that can be stored. Containers or blobs, that's one option. File shares, this is like if you want to share files across systems, you can use this option. Table storage is like a key value pair. And queues for storing queue data. If you want to pump in some messages, you can use this. So we'll be using the containers option, and we can use this storage explorer preview to see the files. And in file systems, we have some file systems created here. So this is like your main container or main place where you will start storing the files. So if you want to create new file system or a parent level folder, you can create it from the file systems. Then, associated with your storage account, you have things like the access keys. So every storage account has a sort of encryption key which is used. So there are two, we can see them here. This is used by the API. So if your application is using, let's say, Java or .NET API, you will need this key to connect to this particular storage account. Then we can use encryption to encrypt the data in that storage account. So by default, whatever you put in the storage account, Microsoft will use its own encryption key and encrypt the data. But for compliance reason, let's say your company has a policy that you don't trust Microsoft, no matter how Microsoft says, you know, we have all the certifications. But it is possible that certain government regulations might require you to have control over the keys. So you can use customer managed keys here. You can bring your own key and you can store the key here and overwrite the default key which is provided by Microsoft. Here is another option where you can override that networks which can be used to connect. So you can specify that VNet here, saying that you can give the range, like the firewall, or you can also give virtual network, the range of IPs from where you can connect to this storage account. Right now, I will just allow public. And the other thing you would need is this. So for each of the service, like the blob service, file service, queue, table storage, data lake storage, they have the public endpoint. So if you require a public endpoint to be provided somewhere, you can come here and you can see the endpoint which is used by the service. So this is like the management portal for the storage account. So if you are, let's say, an administrator, you would probably use this. But if you are a developer, or if you are a person who is actually working with the files, you would need a way to upload or download the files. And that's where the option of Storage Explorer Preview comes in, where we can use this online explorer to upload or download the files. So you have the option of upload here, download. You can create subfolders, and you can control at this level, at the folder level, who has the access. So this is that added security which I was talking about, where you can give access permissions right at the level of the folder, which is not possible with the version 1 of storage account. So this is online. If you want a client tool, then you have the option of using Storage Explorer. So this is a cross-platform tool. Nowadays, you would have seen Microsoft is quite open in terms of building cross-platform tools for everybody. So Storage Explorer is one example where you can use it on Windows, you can use it on Mac, Linux, anywhere. While it logs me in into my account, any questions so far? Are you still awake?
Yes.
Is it still interesting or
yes.
Getting
boring? I just have a question.
Yeah.
What if you come from AWS? How easy it is to adopt Azure?
So the question is, if you come from AWS, how easy it is to adopt to Azure? I would say it's like if you are a developer, how easy or difficult is it to move from, let's say, C# to Java, or Java to Scala, Java to Python? Can you do it? It's the same when it comes to cloud, in my opinion. The parity of services, if you look at them, right, they are almost the same. There is actually a nice blog post where they compare what services are available on AWS, what services are available on Azure, what services are available on GCP, what is equivalent among them, what is different. So if you understand what is on AWS, you most likely have 90% similar stuff on Azure. It's just that the service name would be different, the integration would be different. So AWS, for example, might have a different identity mechanism to authorize you to log into those resources. Azure might use something like Azure Active Directory. So those are subtle variations, subtle differences you will have to understand. But the basic, they still remain the same. It's all about knowing how compute works, how networking works, how storage works. So if you understand that, you can put your language knowledge onto the other platform. That's my opinion. Okay, so this is the client tool, which will allow you to log into your subscription, and then you will be able to see your storage accounts, and you will be able to interact with them. So this is the account which I was showing you on the portal. I can drill down, I can go to font, quite small, but It's the same structure here. So you have that football ML latest for poly based, and you go into one of this, you will be able to do the same thing. So upload, download new folder, you will be able to view the rights from here. So this is the client tool if you want to use something on your local machine. So let's go back to the presentation and look at the next component. Azure Data Factory. So we looked at the storage part, which was the base component, I would say, for any of those services. Azure Data Factory is your cloud-based ETL service. And what I mean by cloud-based is you can connect. So if you look at this diagram here, it supports more than about 90 or 95 connectors by default. You can connect to any of these relational sources, non-relational, media, social media. You can connect to NoSQL databases like MongoDB, Cassandra. There is Spark connectivity. And in terms of languages, it supports .NET, Java, Python, R, Ruby. So if you want to be like a data scientist who's got all this in his profile saying, I know these stuff, and if you really know how to work with those, you can actually use Data Factory to work with that. It also has integration with PaaS services like machine learning. And then it can connect to your on-premise sources as well as cloud. So what you get is, if you're using, let's say, SSIS, for example, to do your ETL, you need to install SSIS. You need to have Visual Studio or SSDT installed on your laptop. Whereas here, everything is on cloud. You don't need any installation. You can build a similar data flow using Data Factory. It gives you a serverless data platform for integration. So Data Factory comes with what is called as integration runtime. So this is like an execution engine which it uses to execute the pipelines that we build. So there are three different ones, and I'll show you in the portal, which are the three. First one is the default, or what is called as the automatic runtime. So let's go back. And again, like most other services or resources in Azure, you have two types of access. So this one, I would say, is more for administrator or someone who is managing the platform, where once you go into the Data Factory, to build a Data Factory, you will have to go through the same process of create new resource, Data Factory, give which resource group you want, and name those common things. Once it's built, you will have this access. So I will not repeat those same steps of creating the resource in the infrastructure. Okay. But this is your first screen when you come to the overview of Data Factory. And you can see there is a monitoring thing, what has been run during a particular period of time. And it gives you different capabilities that the platform has. And if you want to start authoring your ETL pipelines using Data Factory, you go to monitor and author. And it gives you a nice getting started kind of UI. So if you want to build a very simple pipeline, let's say you're just getting familiarized with Data Factory, you can use these quick starts. But if you want to build something complex, this is where you would come. So you go on author, and you will see pipelines, data sets, data flows, and at the bottom you have connections and data. So let's look at the connections in the first place, and integration runtime. Let me just increase the font. Is it okay? Can you see it? Okay. in the connection, by default, you have something called as auto reservoir runtime. So this is what Azure provides. It automatically resolves things for you. And you can add new ones here. The second one, first one, which is called as Azure Self-Hosted. So if you have, let's say, an on-premise database, a SQL Server or Oracle, and you want to pump in data from your on-premise database onto the Azure Data Factory, you need a sort of connection back into your on-premise data source. So you need to install this Azure Self-Hosted runtime somewhere, either on a VM in cloud or onto your machine in your own network. And then that will have the runtime to connect to the data factory. Azure SSIS is a very specific case where you want to use lift and shift. So let's say your organization has been using SSIS for quite a long period of time, and you have built SSIS packages, and you don't want to rewrite them into Data Factory. You want to reuse them. Then you will create a Azure SSIS runtime, and this will be hosted in the cloud. So this is like a VM which has SSIS runtime installed on that, and that is the one which is actually executing your SSIS packages. So based on your requirement, you create these runtimes, and once the runtime is available, you link them to what is called as the link service. So link service is basically your connection. It's a source and destination. So I have a few link services created here. So first one is for the Azure SQL database. There is Databricks. So let's click on new and see what do we get. Okay, so this is the 90 plus connectors which I was talking about, the default ones which comes with Databricks. So you have things which are native to Azure, like Blob Storage, MongoDB, all this Azure specific ones. Then you can go to database. It connects to Amazon Redshift, Impala, Data Storage, SQL, DB2. So typically all your common databases are covered here. You have support for S3 when it comes to files, FTP, file system, Hive, SFTP. Generic protocols, NoSQL, and then services. So here you have connectivity to many, like Salesforce, you have SAP. So you can connect to all these sources by default. So let's say you want to connect to one of the Azure databases. For this particular service or link, and then you provide the typical connection details. What is the server name, what is the user, what kind of authentication you want, where do you want to store the password, is it manually entered or you want to store it in a centralized key vault, any additional properties or parameters, and then you create that. You can test and create. If everything is fine, you will have the service created here. Once you have the service, it's like your connection to a particular source or a target. Then you need to create the data set. Nice ringtone.
Sorry.
So in dataset, again, you basically choose what is your source or what is the target. It will ask you where, but you can use the link service. So let's say I want to use the same Azure SQL. Then if I have a link service already created, I can say use this link service and create a new dataset. and then you specify all the details, like in case of table name, which table you want to see. So let's say this is the adventure works and I want to see the product data. I can do a quick preview. All okay. I can define a schema, import a schema here, and then I can say publish this data set. So if everything is fine with your connection, you will have the data set published and it's available for use. So how do we use this? One option is to create a data flow. The other option is to use something called as pipeline. So in the pipeline, you can create a new pipeline, and this is where you get the power of doing the online ATL. So you have things for moving, you have the things for batch services, data breaks, you have general things like your loops, for each if condition. So any of this can be used as part of your data flow. So typically this is what you would do in SSIS, right?
Yes. So I can access multiple data sources, for example, or a platform.
Yes.
Again, get data from those sources, right?
Yeah. So the question was, can you access data from multiple sources? It's possible. So if you look at my data sets here, right? You can see this one is coming, AdventureWorks is a SQL. This is CSV file, matches CSV. This one is SQL Data Warehouse. So I can choose these data sets. I build a connection to that particular source. I define what is the schema, what is the table, and then I can use it. So once it's available, once it's validated, it can be used in any of these pipelines. Okay, so the simplest thing is to copy the data. And for each of these activities, again, you will have sub-properties, like you give a general name, some general information about how many retries you want, what should be the retry interval, what should be the timeout, these kind of things at the pipeline level. You define what is the source for this activity. So this is where you will use that data set. So to answer your question, those data sets which are already created, they will appear here. So let's say I want to use this customer. That's my source. Now I want to do something with that source. I want to write it somewhere. So let's say I want to write it to a SQL warehouse. Then I can use one of the available copy methods like polybase or command or bulk insert, and I can do the mapping here. So this is where you define source to target. If you want to use the same data types, if you want to use the same name, and then you define what is your integration units. So this is where you have the choice of going with auto, which platform would decide, or if you know what is the volume of data, if you know based on past experience how much resources you would need, you can allocate the number of resources here. So a data factory will charge you based on the number of pipelines and the volume of data that is transferred. So you can say, I want to run, let's say, 4. So your charge would be different when you use 4 units as compared to the auto one. look at the second one, which is the data flows. So if you want to create a data flow, and you can click on new data flow here, you will come to the screen, which is the data flow editor. And this is where you can create what is called as no code data flow. You don't have to code any SQL or anything. You define the steps. So in this case, I'm using one of the data set, which is this data set related to the football matches which happened in England. So I hope everybody understands a bit of football. Yes. So this data set has about 198K records, or about 200,000 records, for different seasons, different team names, when was the match happened, or the date of the season, how many goals were scored by home team, how many visitor goals were scored, what is the goals difference, and what's the result of that particular match. So I'm using this data set, and then I'm doing a sort of data flow on top of that. So what I want to do is, I want to calculate what is the away score, what is the home score, then I want to merge that. I want to create something called as merge data set of all the scores, and then I do some sort of analytics on that particular merge score. So I want to see like season, division, and by the team, what is the ranking of a particular team in a particular season. And then I want to write it somewhere. So this uses Apache Spark in the background when you use the no code approach. And this code will not execute unless you have somewhere output to be written. It needs that trigger where the data needs to be stored. So I'm writing this to data warehouse as one option. And the same data set, I'm also writing it to CSV. Yeah. It's the same data set which is going into analytics CSV. So this is where you can do like branch. You use the same source, but you're writing it into two different branches. And you have things like you can do join, you can do conditional split, you can do things like union, exist, you can do lookup. You can have derived columns, aggregate, surrogate case. So typically what you will do in, let's say, SSIS package where you're moving data from your raw zone into a sort of process zone, you can do all this with just few clicks. And again, when you click on each of these activities, you will have, you know, options to optimize. You will have, based on the type of your activity, you will have the option of specifying more details. So here you can see I have the option of group by. I can specify which are the columns I'm using for groups. I can also specify which are the columns for aggregations, wins, loses, stuff like that. And once I've built this, I can debug it live. Coming up. there is also another good feature which is coming from the CI/CD sort of background. You can see the code that is generated. If you click on the code, it will give you all the things as a JSON file. You can take this, put it in your source control, and you can automate this process. So you build it in one environment, you put it in your, let's say, Git or Bitbucket repository, and then you can push it from one environment to another. Runtime comes up, we can look at the other option, which is for monitoring. So Data Factory is not just ETL, it's also a sort of orchestrator. So you can use it for creating those pipelines and trigger those pipelines. So here I have one example where I have scheduled this football analysis to run on daily basis. So I can come here and I can rerun that, or I can see what was the previous execution. And you can see for the output, so this is like the last step. What all transformations went in to arrive at this particular step? How many records were transitioned from each phase, each stages of your transformation? And how much time did it take? So you can use this to debug your data flow. Can Data Factory be used for real-time data integration? Yes, you can use it for real-time data integration. It's possible. So in your connection, you will have a connection to a real-time data source like the Azure Event Hub. You can base it on time or base it on event. So that would base on your event source itself. You can also use these alerts and metrics to define some alerts, and you also get this dashboard saying how many pipelines are running, how many activities are running, and you have this option of filtering based on the range within a day, within a month, or any time frame. So again, in the interest of the time, I will not execute this pipeline, but if I were to execute the pipeline, you would have seen that same green color screenshot which I showed before, right? What steps went through, and you will be able to see the similar output. Looks like there is some network problem why it's taking so long time to provision that particular autoresolver runtime. Let's move on to the next service.
Can you create a connection that connects to a local resource instead of a cloud, an on-premise
yes.
file, for example?
It's possible. So this is one example of the copy activity. So if you use that quick start, right, you will see something similar. So the quick start will ask you where is your source, credentials to connect to your source, and the output or the target, and you will get this nice summary of what happened during that particular activity. So we looked at this, we looked at these sources, we looked at this mapping data source. For this particular case, I would give a credit to this guy called Arun Legos, who built the initial pipeline, and my addition to that was writing it to the SQL warehouse. This guy is writing just to a
CSV file. So I can say I got inspired by him and enhanced his feature. So we looked at this, the dashboard, we looked at the runtime and the pipeline option. Next one is Azure Databricks. So what is Databricks? As I said, Databricks is the company which owns or which maintains the Spark code. Spark is quite popular. Everybody nowadays has some or the other link to Spark because it's a framework which allows you to do massive parallel processing on the data which is in memory. And it's very, very fast compared to many of the legacy kind of operations. And what Databricks gives you as part of the Databricks runtime is what is called as the unified analytics platform. So you have this cloud services at the bottom, which supports Azure as well as AWS. You have all this support. So you have the streaming support. You can connect to Hadoop data source, data warehouses. So that's the cloud integration part. On top of that, the runtime gives you Spark by default. There is something called as Databricks Delta. Anybody is working with Hadoop and Hive? Okay, so if you work with Hadoop, you know that it's append-only system. You cannot overwrite by default in Hadoop. Hive, again, you cannot overwrite in Hive in the older versions. The new version of Hive supports a sort of observe. What Delta does is it improves on that kind of feature. You don't need a Hive to do a observe. Okay. So this is a very recent feature which is open source by Databricks, and they integrated it in the runtime for their service. Apart from that, so this kicks in when you want to build a data lake using Databricks. You also have the machine learning support. So the platform comes with most commonly used libraries for machine learning like TensorFlow, you have XGBoost, PyTorch, MLflow. All this comes pre-built. So if you know how to build, let's say, a cluster of Spark, anybody has built or tried building a Spark cluster? No? Okay. It's a nightmare, I can tell you. It's not so easy. So this platform makes it so easy for you that you choose what you want. So I'll show you in the cluster creation step, and it provisions all this for you. So it really makes your workflow agile. So you don't need to be like a Unix admin or a Databricks specific or Spark admin. You can build the complete platform with very minimal knowledge. And then you have at the top of this sort of enterprise feature, which is called as Workspace. So Workspace allows you to create notebooks, it allows you to schedule jobs, and it allows you to give permissions and stuff like that. So let's look at this. So I'll close Data Factory and let's move on to the Databricks part. So the drill is again similar here. To create the service, you say create new Azure Databricks. It will ask you those same questions, which resource group, what is the name. Once you create it, you will have this page. So this is like the management layer of Azure Databricks. And you have the admin guide and all the guides available. And to go into the Databricks workspace, you say launch. So the first part is what is linked between the Azure and the Databricks, and this is really the Databricks part. So this is managed by Databricks. Okay. So that's why you see a screen which says use your Active Directory login to log into that service. Okay. So in Databricks, you have your workspace, you have data, there are clusters, jobs. So let's start first with the clusters part. Create cluster. You give a name and you have the option of creating two types of cluster. One is standard, one is high concurrency. So standard is if you just want to execute a job. So it's like a single user cluster or a cluster which is used specifically for running jobs in production like scenario. Nobody is going to use
log into this particular cluster. So it's like you create your pipelines, you build your jobs, deploy it, and this cluster gets up and running. High concurrency is if you want to use it for, let's say, exploratory analysis. There's a data scientist who wants to explore the data, he wants to build a machine learning model. In that case, you would use the high concurrency cluster. A pool is like you can define a set of resources which the cluster can then attach itself. So it's like if you create the cluster from the scratch, it will take maybe 15 minutes to provision the whole cluster. If your resources can't wait or if your jobs can't wait for so long, you can create a pre-built pool and say my cluster will use resources from this pool. Runtime. This is what Databricks provides in terms of optimization. So based on a particular version, you will get a combination of Spark, Python, for example, the support for those machine learning libraries, and whether you want CPU or GPU-based cluster. So you choose a particular version of Databricks runtime and its associated dependencies. Then you have the option of, I think at the back, this is very, very small. And if I zoom it more, it will be even more worse. So apologies for that. But you have the option of enabling auto-scaling. So what this does is, based on the workload of your cluster, you can say start with 4 nodes. If the workload increases and those 4 nodes, they cannot sustain that load, increase. And you can define the limits. So here you can see minimum workers and maximum workers. So you can define that range within which you want to auto-scale the cluster. And if the cluster is not in use after a certain period of time, then you can terminate the cluster. So this gives you both scale out as well as scale down, or scale up and scale down capabilities.
Sure. Can you set up those cluster nodes on various computers?
You mean across the regions?
Yeah, across the region.
I haven't tried it. I don't think it's possible because your service is created in a particular region. When you create the workspace, it's attached to a particular region. I haven't seriously explored that. So, I don't know, frankly, the answer for that. But maybe it's not possible because your service links to a particular region at the time of creation. That's my assumption.
By auto-scaling, we're referring to number of workers, right, being deployed. So here in the terminate after X minutes of activity, we kill all or we terminate all the workers.
This is the whole cluster. So your master as well as the workers would be killed.
Then there's no auto-scaling of workers.
There is no scaling down option.
Down.
This is scaling up.
Okay.
Scaling down, you will have to do it based on some metrics.
Okay. So there's a way.
Yes. Okay, so let's move a bit quicker here. That's the cluster creation. So again, I have created the cluster beforehand because it takes some time here. So those of you who have used Hive, this is using Hive Metastore behind the scenes. It's built on top of Hive Metastore. So you have, again, the concept of databases and tables. So there is a default database, and it gives you a view. So if you work with Cloudera or Hortonworks, they would give a sort of UI just to see the schema and the data, right? This is similar. But our main purpose is to look at the notebooks, which is one of the most useful feature. So each user has its own workspace, and you can create a notebook here. You can create library, folder, machine learning experiments. When you go to notebook, based on again what you selected as your runtime, you will have support for this. By default, you have support for Python, Scala, SQL, or R. So this is the programming language of the default notebook that you create, or default language for a particular notebook. But
you would mix and match.
Yes. So if you've used Jupyter Notebook, for example, you know that magic cells concept, right? You put percentage, then the type of language or the kind of runtime you want to use.
Okay.
The concept is similar here.
Ah.
So let me show you one of the existing notebook. So I created this as a Scala notebook. And I haven't mixed anything in this case, but let's run it for a moment. So let me just clear all the states from the previous result. So it's an empty notebook. Let's run all. Okay, so for those guys familiar with Jupyter, this is exactly similar to Jupyter. Nothing fancy. It is in a way Jupyter notebook. Okay. So let's say I want to use one of this table. I would have stored the table somewhere. So let me just walk you through this notebook, what it's doing. The first two steps are like the prerequisite, where you're connecting to a storage account. So this Databricks is trying to connect to my storage account in that CSV file where it's stored. I'm using Spark Read to read the CSV with header, and I'm saying infer the schema. So see if you can find what's the schema for this england.csv file. And if you look at this output, it will show you the schema, what it has automatically inferred. So it says ID is integer, date, because it's not a recognized date format, it reads with a string, and so on and so forth. Then I can also see some records here using display function. And again, for those who have not seen the Jupyter functionality, this is a good feature. Instead of just showing tabular, you can change the view and you can do grouping, filtering, you can use this kind of visualization within your notebook. And here I'm storing that back into the data lake storage using different formats. So I'm saying read it as CSV, but store it as Parquet. So anybody has heard about Parquet data file format or ORC? Yes, no? Okay. So Parquet is one of the most popular format when it comes to object storage. This is a columnar format. So instead of storing data in rows, it stores the data in columns. And what it does by that is it optimizes the storage. So I have a small analysis done on a couple of files. So the first one is this matches.csv. In CSV format, it's about, let's say, 20 MB. When I store it as Parquet, it compresses that data and it reduces the file size by about 80%. So this again will depend on the type of data that you have in that file. So let's say everything is integer. This I pretty sure would be much more than 80%, because you can compress integers much more better than strings. Okay. If I store it as delta, it's reducing the file size by 39%. If I store it as ORC, which is again another format for columnar, it reduces the file size by about 77%. I have another data set which is movies based. It's a ratings data file which is about 750 MB. So this gets reduced about 76% in all three scenarios. So I highly recommend that you should use Parquet or ORC formats if you are working with big data. The other advantage you get is in terms of querying. So I have another notebook, which is just comparing the file size. So here, let's run this one. Is it a sign that I have to stop here?
We're not timing your talk, so just continue. But please end within 11 a.m. Try your best.
6 minutes, okay. Give me 5 minutes more.
So that we could have our lunch.
So I've left that notebook, and what I'm doing is storing it as CSV, then storing it at Parquet, storing it as delta file, storing it as ORC, and then when I try to see the file sizes, you would see what I showed you on the Excel. To show one more thing, which is the query performance. And why I recommend that you should use Parquet or ORC. So here, I am reading CSV file. I am selecting a couple of columns from that. So this particular CSV file is movie ratings. There is a I think 200 million data set for movies. It's specifically used for ML experiment, machine learning. You can find this online. It's called MLLatest. It's a company or an organization which provides this data set. So I'm using one of this. So this, it's reading that CSV and it's doing a sort of filter for ratings which are greater than 4. So it's a typical kind of, read from a file, then do a filter, and then try to display the result. Let's see what happens here. How much time did it take? About 12 seconds to read a CSV file and do this filtering and order by. And then I'm also doing, on the movie ID and user ID, a sort of aggregation, min and max. So this takes about 10 seconds. When it comes to Parquet, it takes about 2 seconds to read the same amount of data. Okay. Then, when it comes to aggregation, it takes about 4 seconds. Same, data set is same, okay? When it comes to ORC, so your ORC read is about 2 seconds. Okay. And your aggregation is about 4 seconds. So why does this happen? Because of that, the row columnar format or columnar format which I was talking about. CSV, by default, it can't split the file. So if you have a row or if you have column in that, let's say even if I'm selecting just 2 columns from a row, it has to read the complete row, right? That's the disadvantage. Whereas with these columnar stores, you can read only that particular column because that column is stored. So let me just go here and show you how did it arrive at this. So this is for Parquet. You can see here the input for that was just 16 MB. So out of that 750 MB original file, to do that filter and aggregation based on this rating equal to 4 and this movie ID and user ID, 2 columns and 1 filter, it read only 16 MB of data. Whereas when it came to CSV, first of all, you can see the number of jobs it had to execute. In Parquet, it was just 2 stages. Here, it has to go through all these stages, and if you look at each one of these, you will see that it would be at some point reading all the data. 64 KB here in one of the tasks. So that's the difference, 600 MB compared to 16 MB. So you can see if you have data which is in, let's say, gigabytes or terabytes, and you have to process that, how much difference this can make in your processing. Okay. Mm-hmm. last part I would like to show here is how do we integrate this with the warehouse. So let's say I'm doing some sort of analysis and combining the data set here. So I'm reading the movies and the ratings, then I'm filtering some rating, and then at some point I'm doing join between two different data sets. So this is between the movies and the ratings. So I have two different data sets. I join them based on movie ID. And let's say I want to get the top 10. I get these top 10 movies based on those ratings. And I want to write it to the SQL warehouse. So Databricks, and because Azure Databricks is a first party service, you have a special driver called as SQL DW, or a format which it uses. You give the JDBC option, the URL, the connection string to your SQL warehouse, which table you want to create, then specify a time directory. So this is for Polybase. So Polybase is a technology which allows you to read big data, like Hadoop related data, into SQL Server. So in SQL warehouse, this is extended, and this particular Spark Databricks uses Polybase in the background to do bulk insert. So even if this is doing like processing in memory, it will write the temporary results into a storage account, and in one shot it pushes them into the warehouse. That's for the optimization. So it uses this temp directory only for the temporary data, and we are storing this in our data storage or storage account. So that's the links. So when you create a SQL warehouse, right, it comes with its own storage account. And in this case, we are using our storage account, which is outside of that boundary of the SQL warehouse.
Wow.
That's why we need this temp directory to be specified and a link to be created between Databricks and storage account and the data warehouse.
Okay.
And then you can specify which mode, whether you want to use append mode or overwrite mode to write it to the target table. So in this case, if the table is not there in the database, it will create it. If it exists, it will just use the same table. Okay. So we looked at the cluster settings. We looked at, okay, so this is what I was telling you. So when Databricks and data warehouse, they talk to one another, right? It needs a storage account where that data is stored. It uses something called as managed service ID to connect to the warehouse, and it uses the JDBC connection between Spark and the warehouse. Okay, jobs. So jobs is the next feature in Databricks, where once you have created that notebook, you can schedule it. Here, you can choose either a notebook, or if you already have a jar. So let's say you have a Spark program written and you have created a jar file, you can upload it to Databricks. You can schedule that jar to be run. In this case, I am using a particular notebook. So any of those notebooks which I showed, I can select them here and schedule them to run. So I can run immediately, or I can define a schedule. That's also possible. So it creates a cron job in the background where it will run this. And the last part, which is SQL data warehouse. So I hope you are still with me.
Yes.
So what is SQL data warehouse? SQL data warehouse is renamed in the latest version of Azure sometime in November. It's called Azure Synapse nowadays. It gives you SQL analytics capabilities or SQL query capabilities over the big data. So Previously, if you wanted to query big data, you needed Spark or you needed Python, this kind of knowledge. But with Synapse, you have that built into your Azure capabilities itself. So it's a parallel data warehouse. If you used SQL in the past, but on cloud. Okay. So what you get right now is Synapse Analytics is generally available, and you have various features which are currently available in GA, but there are also preview which are coming up. So in the future version, they are going to combine the data factory, Databricks, and the storage into one studio, which is the analytics GA. It's called as the studio here, this part. And that has integration with a bunch of Spark as well. So you don't need these separate services. Those are combined together.
Which is the SASPS now?
No, no. SASPS is still there.
Still there, okay.
So here is a quick, I will not go through each one of this. I'll share the slides. Again, this comes from James Sarah. So the difference between SQL Server and SQL Warehouse is the SQL Server is your symmetric multiprocessing where you have one server doing all the tasks using multiple CPUs or cores. Whereas in MPP, there are different servers who are doing tasks individually. And by default, when you create a data warehouse, it creates 60 servers in the background. So if you create a table, it will go and sit on 60 different nodes, and it uses this shared nothing architecture where you have a control node, there is a data movement service which manages your queries. So you send a request or your query to the control node and it will run it in parallel on all the 16 nodes. So this is how it looks. And there is the option to replicate and distribute the table. So you have different algorithms to distribute the table across these 60 different nodes. Okay. So here you can specify the partition as well, to partition the data. You can also use the distribution as hash is one option. There is round robin as another option. So you can provide a key which is used to distribute your data across those different nodes. Okay. So this is what is called as the level of parallelism. So when you create a SQL data warehouse, you create with what is called as data warehouse units. So if you create it with 100 units, it will have one worker assigned. And that one worker will be interacting with your 60 nodes in the background. If you create it with a higher value of data warehouse units, let's say 600, it will have six different workers. So this is to manage your number of parallel workers that you have. And based on the number of workers, again, you will pay your bill. So as long as you can pay for the number of workers, you can provision the...
One worker is one instance or compute instance? Okay.
Yeah. Okay, Azure Keyword. So Azure Keyword is a very critical component, I would say. This is what you can use for storing all your secrets, passwords, connection strings. In cloud environment, you need a way to manage your secrets, and other keywords is a means of keyword. The other one is Active Directory. So this one you can use for managing the identity. So you can create service accounts, or you can have your AD users into Azure Active Directory, and you can use it for your businesses. So here are some references to the links to the different topics that I discussed during this session. I was supposed to show Power BI as well as part of visualization, but I think there is a dashboard in a day or half a day, and Power BI might be a more suitable topic for that. So there is nothing changes in terms of Power BI connectivity to SQL DevOps. It's the same way. The way you connect to an on-premise SQL server, you will use the same connection string, username, password. So I won't repeat the same stuff. So thank you. Thanks a lot. The slides are available in case you want to have a look at those after this. Any further questions? So this is for the feedback.
Yes. Make sure that you answer the feedback session. No, no feedback, no rattle.
Okay. While you are doing the feedback, I've got some stickers, laptop stickers, in case you are like me and you want to decorate your laptop.
Yeah.
Grab them. So any questions?
Ay, feedback daw, feedback. Discard mo lang yung variable, receive equivalence. Ayaw ko may mic. Equivalence.
O, yung ano, mga app.
So if there are no more questions, thank you. Thanks for attending the session. I hope it was useful. Thanks a lot.